Hello viewers, so today we will discuss on the orientation of Hatt Pradipika. In this sequence, we have already discussed in our previous lecture the relationship between the Raj Yoga and Hatha Yoga, and then we have already discussed on the place, the importance of place in the Hatha Yogic practices. So, in the carrying on our discussion further, we are going towards our next lecture, and our today's lecture plan, we will discuss on the destructive and constructive elements of Hatha Yogic practices. In Hatha Yogic practices, we can see that so many things are very destructive and they can stop our Hatha Yogic practices, and some elements are very essential and very useful if we make them implement in our Hatha Yogic practices, and if we put them in our Hatha Yogic practices, so our Hatha Yogic practices will become more constructive and more helpful for the achievements of yoga. Now, the main object of this discussion is that the Hatha Yoga is already described as to increase the duration and flow of Sushumna, and the period when the both nostril flow simultaneously, so that the balance is created in the physical and mental functions. So, now we already have seen that there are two main channels, Ida and Pingala, and in the middle channel is very important in the Hatha Yogic practices, because we have to awake the middle channel, and through the awakening of that middle channel, we can implement and we can get the force of Kundalini Shakti or Kundalini, the power of Kundalini. Through this achievement, we can make a good harmony between the body and mind. So, now in our previous lecture, we have already discussed these three nadis and the importance of these three nadis, because this is the central channel and we have to awake this central channel by the help of Hatha Yogic practices. All these Hatha Yogic practices are especially useful for the purification of these two subsidiary channels named as Ida and Pingala. So, by the purification of these subsidiary channels of in relation to middle channel, we can also make the purification of these Ida and Pingala, and then we can directly move the prana into the main central channel. So, this will help us to awake the Kundalini power, the serpent power, and by the help of that serpent power, we can make the revelation, we can make the our body full of zeal, full of vitality, and we can rectify all the mental and physical problems from our body and mind. So, this is the main aim of Hatha Yoga. So, we have already discussed that body and mind are not functioning in harmony, and if they are not functioning in harmony, there is a division between the physical and mental rhythm, which inevitably leads the sickness. So, this is the main cause of problems in our body, because if our body and mind are not functioning in harmony, it means that sometimes we see that some problems comes from body to mind and some problems come from the mind to body. So, these problems are termed as sometimes psychosomatic and somatopsychic problems. So, through these problems, we face so many physical and mental problems in our life. So, this is the main cause of sickness according to our yogic texts. So, far as the aspirant, it is very necessary to maintain the harmony for the higher goals of yoga. If really in reality, if you want to achieve the higher goals in yoga, so this is very necessary to make a harmony between, or to make a perfect balance between the body and mind. So, by the help of perfect balance between body and mind, we can achieve the more and more higher goals in the Hatha Yogic practices and in the Raj Yogic practices. As we have already discussed that Hatha Yoga and Raj Yoga both are interlinked and both are very well communicated. But in some cases, we see that this ideal concept of Hatha Yoga practices breaks due to the various reason, and it finally disturbs our goal of yoga. But in some cases, we feel that various elements helps the aspirant to move forward into the Hatha Yogic practices and accelerate the speed of practice. So many cases we faces in the time of practice that sometimes all this harmony between the body and mind break, and this harmony between body and mind break due to some environmental causes, due to some bodily causes, due to some so many social causes, and all these causes stop our practice. But in some cases, so many environmental, so many social, and so many our bodily and our mentally, these cases are very helpful for us for moving us towards the more higher goals of Hatha Yogic practices. And sometimes we see that so many social conditions, so many environmental conditions accelerate the speed of our practice in the Hatha yogic traditions or in the Hatha yogic practices. So we see these problems or these things in our daily Hatha yogic practices. Now, the element disturb the continuity and rhythm of our practices are known as destructive elements for the Hatha yogic practices. As when we go towards the Hatha yoga system, so we will see that some social conditions, some mental conditions, some bodily conditions are very not suitable for the our goal of Hatha yogic practices. So, all those practices, all those things or all those elements are we can put them in the destructive elements corner. So, but and the elements which are helpful or which maintain the rhythm and continuity of the practice are known as constructive elements for the Hatha yogic practices. In the same way, there are two sides, some are destructive elements, some are constructive elements. So, the destructive elements always stop our practice and always obstruct our practice anyhow. But in the case of constructive elements, they always boost up in our practice, they always gives the advancement in our yogic practices. That is why there are the two categories which are very described before in the beginning of the Hatha Yoga Pradipika, because these are very important to know the practical applications before going towards the practical methods or techniques of Hatha Yoga Pradipika or Hatha Yoga tradition. We have to know these things very clearly, because these may makes the discipline of Hatha yogic practices. So, now the destructive and constructive elements are step by step described as there are six causes which destroy the continuity of Hatha yoga explained in the Hatha Pradipika. These causes are overeating, exertion, talkativeness, adherence to rules, being in company of the common people and unsteadiness. So, these are the things which are very destructive for the Hatha yogic practices, because these always obstruct the path of our Hatha yogic practices. One by one we will discuss how they will stop the our Hatha yogic practices, they will stop the growth and they will stop the speed of our Hatha yogic practices. First we can see one by one overeating. So, for example, this is one of the major obstacles. When the body is loaded with food, it becomes sluggish, heavy, and the mind becomes dull. In this result, we see toxin build up in the body, constipation occurs, and whole system becomes blocked. So, overeating is very harmful for our practices. So, that is why there the always we prescribe in our yogic diet the low calorie food, and sometimes we also prescribe the low level of food, and we never emphasize on food more in the Hatha yogic practices. This is the reason, because if we overeat, if we are taking more and more food to the body, so the energy of the body will consume to in the digestion of that particular food which we are taking in the in duration of the practice. So, the thing or the energy which is needed for the acceleration in our practice will divert towards the digestion of that particular food. So, it means that overeating is very harmful, and it will directly or indirectly affects our yogic practice. So, in the same way we see exertion. If we are taking more and more exertion, so exertion is also very harmful and also very destructive in the Hatha yogic practices. So, overstraining the mind and body, hard physical labor or intense mental work taxes one of the energy system and can create further imbalance between the two energies, that is known as the mental energy and the bodily energy. So, the bodily energy and mental energy both becomes disharmonized due to overexertion or overstraining the body. So, the aspirant has to conserve and build up his store of energy for the spiritual purpose and should not waste it in any unnecessary physical and mental work. So, this is very necessary for a aspirant or for a practitioner of Hatha yoga, that he or she should have to make conserve his body and mind energy, because if he is giving more strain and over strain to his body and mind, so he cannot do he cannot make hardship in the Hatha yogic practices, because Hatha yogic practices also need some hardship of physical and mental. So, if we are making more strain, if we are giving more strain or more physical hardship in the other activities, so the bodily energy which is needed for the achievement in the hatha yogic practices will divert directly into the that particular work or particular hardship. So this is needed that to avoid exertion in duration of hatha yogic practices. Now see talkativeness, too much talking dissipate vital energy and wastes time, and which could be better spent in awakening the inner awareness. If we are talking so much, we are sharing our experiences, we are talking without any having any sense, we are talking in so many issues. So it means that we are wasting our sound energy, we are wasting our vocal energy, and if we are wasting our vocal energy, so this vocal energy should be used in some positive work, some advancement in the hatha yogic practices. But we are socially communicating more and more, so it means that we are not only wasting our vocal energy, but we are also wasting our mental energy in communication with the others. So social situation and irrelevant discussions definitely distract the mind from the yogic practices. So this talkativeness, one side decrease our vocal energy through our talking to the social on the social issues, and in the same time this energy also reduce the mental energy, and these things directly or indirectly stop our hatha yogic practices. Now adhering to rules, this is also very major point. When we adhere to the rules, and it makes our mind as narrow, so our mind become narrow, and due to this situation yoga means to expand the conscious net, not to limit it. And if our if we are narrow minded, so we cannot make the success, or we cannot achieve the success in the hatha yogic practices. So there are so many rules, those are described in our hatha yogic texts. As we have already discussed that when we discuss the place for the hatha yogic practices, so in the place of hatha yogic practices, if we are totally emphasizing the place according to the hatha yoga pradipika, so it means that we have to choose a hermitage, we have to build a hermitage very far from the roads, very far from the city. So it will make more danger for us if we totally reside into a forest. So it will make so much of danger for us. So that's why we have not to cling to the rules. Those are described in our text. We have to make some changes. So many religious duties, so many social and morals, those are described in our text, never give success in the path of yoga. So no need to adhere to the religious and social rules if they are not important for the sadhana or for the practice. So because there are so many religious duties which are described in our text, there are so many things, moral issues, those are described in our, we have to communicate with the others, we have to help others. So these are very strictly given in our text. If they are helpful for the achievement or for the success in the path of yoga, we have to carry them. If they are not helpful, if they are not important in our hatha yogic practices, we have to skip from them. So this is very useful thing. Now the company of common people, this is the very harmful thing in the hatha yogic practices, that this is also a major cause for the distract the mind, because more the people approach you, minimize your time to your practice. If the people are approaching you, so they will make your time short, more short for the hatha yogic practices. So avoid the company of the common people. They have no understanding of your of the importance of spiritual practices. So misguidance from them definitely disturb your practice. Now unsteadiness. If you are unsteady in your practice, wavering of body, mind never leads to the right path. It means imbalanced body metabolism, inability to hold one posture for a period of time, and mind's fluctuation cannot give success in the path of yoga. So these six things are very important, and these are the causes finally stop the path of yoga. So unsteadiness, the last one, is also very important in the same way what we have seen in the previous elements. The same, this element is also very important, because if we are not doing our practice, and steadiness means if we are in sickness, so we must do the practice. If we are not doing practice because of our bodily cause, because of our mind cause, so it means that it will stop our way of practice, it will stop the speed of our practice. So wavering body and mind both are equally responsible for the stopping of our practice. So these are very essential things which we have to rectify, which we have to make them away from our practices, because these are the destructive elements of yoga. Now further, the constructive elements are described in detail as enthusiasm, courage, patience, discriminative knowledge, unshakable faith, and avoiding the company of common people. These are the six causes which bring success in yoga. So these are the things the same as we have seen the destructive elements, and destructive elements always try us to stop our practices. So in this sequence further, we see that constructive elements always give success or bring success in yoga. Now one by one we will see their effect and how they will improve our yogic practices. Enthusiasm, so we can say that it has a positive attitude, and it is very necessary, and constant inspiration and ideal attainment perfection generates energy and help to maintain regularity in our practice. So anyhow, enthusiasm gives us more and more energy for the speeding up us into the hatha yogic practices, since it should be remain in the from the beginning to the end. So if it remains in the beginning to the end, it means that it will give us more in every step of our practice. If sometimes the negative energy comes to us, so it will eradicate, it will rectify that negative energy, and it will transform that negative energy into the positive energy, which is very helpful for us in the hatha yogic practices. That's why this is called also known as positive attitude, and this positive attitude always leads us into the hatha yogic practices. So enthusiasm is also very helpful. In the same way, just like the enthusiasm, we also has take the courage. If we are doing the hatha yogic practices, in the hatha yogic practices, when we see there are so many problems, so many difficulties will come to us. So to face those difficulties, we have to put courage in every step of our practice. To face inner vision and realization, courage is very important, because in our inner vision there are so many different things, so many unusual things which we never counter in our daily life. So we have to directly counter with our unconscious mind at that time. So this is very subtle things, these are very inner things. So we have to face our inner vision and realization with courage, and that's why courage is very important, because in spiritual practices we have to face our hidden layers of mind where so many unwanted impressions are suppressed, and without facing we cannot eliminate them. So this is the main reason that courage is very helpful, and because so many hidden aspects, so many hidden things which we sometimes we counter in our dreams, sometimes we counter in our imagination, but in the practice we will face them directly in front of us. Sometimes angers comes in us, sometimes the desires comes in us, bad desires comes in us. So it means that these are the things which are very rooted in our mind. So we have to face them very courageously, and if we have no courage, if we have fear, and if we are afraid in those conditions in which those things comes in front of us, it will stop our practice. So that's why this is very needed in the hatha yogic practices. Courage must be there. Now patience is also very helpful. Without making any hurry in the results of the practices, one should keep going on with patience, and otherwise it will raise so many problems in the practices. Actually there is a description of after every hatha yogic practices we will see that there is a description of more and more results there. and all those results given after a Hatha yogic practice is just for the boosting up us into the Hatha yogic practice. But if we cling to them, oh, these are the results of Hatha yogic practices, and it means that anyhow we have to get the results, get the fruits of that practice, it will give us more harmful situations in our practice. So we have to make patience, and in patience the results will come after some time. It will take more time which we are expecting. If we are expecting 1 week or 2 weeks for getting the results of the particular Hatha yogic practices, it may increase to up to the level of 1 year, 2 year or 3 year. So patience is very needed in the Hatha yogic practices, because we don't know, we have no measurement of our mind, we have no measurement of the bad things in our body. So everything means our body is purifying, our mind is also purifying by the Hatha yogic practices. That's why we don't know whether the results will come after 2 weeks, 3 weeks or after 1 year or 2 year. So that's why we need patience there in the Hatha yogic practices. Next is discriminative knowledge. Everything in the practice should be judged by discrimination. If we have no discrimination, it will break our practice. So discrimination or discriminative knowledge is also very helpful, and this knowledge helps us to choose the right and helping element for the practice. If we are doing the practice and if we have no discriminative knowledge, just for example, if we are seeing in the text that text is describing about the place of Hatha yogic practices, which is very appropriate according to the text, and we are cling to see that particular place for the Hatha yogic practices in our surrounding. So it means that we cannot find, we know where we can find that particular place which is described as it is in the Hatha yogic text. So we have to make some discrimination, we have to make which is very applicable and which is very helpful, which place is very helpful and which element is very helpful for our practices. This is a judgment of right and wrong in the practice, and which includes our diet, place, clothes, stitching, etc. So many things we can include in it. Because diet is also recommended in the Hatha yogic text, place is also recommended in the Hatha yogic text, and clothes and teachings are also recommended in the Hatha yogic text. So with our discriminative knowledge, with our discriminative discernment, we can see that this is very helpful for us and this is not very useful for us in present situation. So seeing the things, the usefulness of those things in the present situation, we have to make them applicable for the Hatha yogic practices. So the unshakable faith means this is also very helpful and very helpful for the achievement or for the success in the Hatha yogic practices, because without any doubt one should not doubt in the master and practice. Both these things means if you are doing under a guidance, under a particular master's guidance, so you should not have any right to doubt on the master's teaching. And the practices which are described, or which are described in our holy text and which are described by our master, the holy masters, so we have we should have not make any doubt on those practices. Because if we really want to achieve the goal, or if we really want to achieve the success in the Hatha yoga practices, so it happens, then the practice will perish, the practice will totally destroy if we have some faith which is shakable in our mind and which is shaking our mind. So if we have these things, so unshakable faith, so it will totally destroy our practice. So practice will become continuous if there is no space for doubt. For example, if we have some doubt in our practice, so it will break our continuity of the practice. If you are doing today's practice and if you are trying to making some time for the next day practice, tomorrow's practice, and it continues for a long time, so after some time a doubt will arise in us. The doubt that we are getting a good results according to the text or not. If we have this doubt that will we get the results according to text or according to our master, and this master is competent or not, who is teaching us is competent or not. So it means that we have doubt on the text, we have doubt on the practice, we have doubt on the masters. So it will totally perish, totally destroy our practice. So make your faith firm in the practice and in the master also, because master is competent. And if we have doubt on the master, it means that we have the doubt on the practice, and we can never get the results in the Hatha yogic practices. Now, avoid the company of the common people. The same thing which we are seeing in the destructive element, that when we company the common people, it means that they will come to us and they will give us more disturbance, they will give us so many difficulties in our Hatha yogic practices. So, it is discussed that company of common people will stop the continuity of practice. That is why we have to make a distance between the company of among the common people. If we indulge into the talk of the common peoples, into the social communication, so it will directly or indirectly affect our practice. Somehow it creates doubts and unwillingness, and sometimes it creates dissatisfaction and a number of mental condition opposite for the Hatha yoga practices. Now, in conclusion, we can say that all the above important discussion gives us a insight into the Hatha yogic practices, because the constructive and destructive, these are the main things which are discussed in Hatha Yoga Pradipika, and both are based on every spiritual practices. These are very base of spiritual practices. So, we need to make them implement, we need to make their application in our life, because in our Hatha yogic practices, if we not include them, they will not help us. Now, according to situation, all these elements are liable to change. And because these conditions were examined, experienced in that situation, actually we have already discussed, when we make a relationship between the Hatha yoga and Raja yoga, then we finally choose a perfect place for the Hatha yogic practices. In that discussion, we already discussed that the place is suitable according to the situation, according to the climatic condition at that time. But now, for the present time, we have to make some changes, and these changes we can make by our discriminative knowledge. That is why discriminative knowledge is discussed under the constructive elements of yoga. So, in the constructive elements of yoga, the discriminative knowledge is there. So, by the help of that discriminative knowledge, we have to make some changes into the constructive and destructive elements of yoga. For example, we can say that excessive use of information technology instruments, excessive use of mobile phones, excessive use of electronics items, they will stop our imagination, they will stop our wavelength, they will stop our imagination range. So, in this way, these electronic items obstruct us our practice into the Hatha yogic practices, because in Hatha yogic practices we need silence, we need more ceasing, we need more stopping of our fluctuations of our mind. But if our mind is fluctuated in various direction by the help of these electronic items, so they will stop our practice. So, this is needed here, these things we can implement, or these things we can make applicable for the present day Hatha yogic practices. For instance, if we want to make re-establish the identity of our holy scriptures, so it is very needed here to make them publicly open and discussion and practice. If we discuss them publicly, if we open for the publicly all these scriptures and practices, so we can make some changes according to present life situation. That is why the various colleges and universities are drawing their attention on the importance and application of these scriptures for the modern life situation. So, in the next lecture, we will discuss on the Yam Niyamas described in the Hatha Yoga Pradipika, and Yam Niyamas are also very helpful, as we have seen in the Patanjali Yoga Sutra. They construct the main category of our practices for the general practitioner. In the same way, the Yam Niyamas described in the Hatha Yoga practices are very helpful for the advancement of our Hatha Yoga practices. Thank you.